So far, we have been looking at the sun as the main source of energy. Solar energy is used directly in photovoltaics or indirectly by wind and biomass. However, we have a renewable source of energy that is right below us, planet Earth. Millions of years ago, planet Earth was nothing but a hot globe of molten rock. Lucky for us, the Earth has cooled down to a point where you don't burn your feet when you go outside. However, the Earth's crust is still only a very thin layer of cold rock, basically floating on a sea of lava. If we go down a few kilometers, we can already start using Earth's heat. The general principle of geothermal energy is relatively simple. Hot water is pumped up from an underground reservoir. The heat in the groundwater is extracted with a heat exchanger and used above ground. The cool water is re-injected in the ground at a different location. The water will permeate through the rock, again collecting in the reservoir, all the while heating up again. The depth of the reservoirs can vary between several hundred meters to 5 kilometers. The underground area from which the water is extracted should be large enough to continuously extract water and to avoid the hot water from mixing with the injected cold water. Often, multiple extraction holes are drilled with a large distance between them. The streams are in a close circle to avoid pollution of the groundwater. The general principle of this type of power station is using hot water from the earth to power steam turbines. This process converts thermal energy into mechanical energy, which in turn is converted into electrical energy with a generator. This principle is also used in conventional coal power plants, biomass plants, and concentrated solar plants. Geothermal energy can also be used on a small private scale. In that case, geothermal refers to the heating and cooling of a house using pipes in the Earth's crust. The Earth's crust has a constant temperature. During winter, the heat in the Earth's crust is used to warm up the house. During summer, the excess heat is stored in the Earth's crust. The geothermal energy in the Earth's crust is a result of the thermal heat flux from the Earth's core and from heat released during the radioactive decay of unstable isotopes in the Earth's crust, like uranium and thorium. The primary geothermal energy potential is equal to the amount of energy radiated from underneath the Earth's crust. We will call this the average heat flux, which is about 50 milliwatts per square meter. Then the average heat exchange is equal to the heat flux multiplied by the reservoir area. The main system efficiencies in a geothermal plant consist of the exchange efficiency between the water reservoir and the rock beneath the crust. Heat losses in the pipe and the thermal to mechanical conversion efficiency of steam turbine also play a role. Finally, the electrical efficiencies are taken into account, which include the efficiency of the generator and transformer. In addition, you may imagine that a high production can only be achieved at places where the permeability of the rock is sufficient. Moreover, to make it economically feasible, it is important that heat can be collected at a reachable depth. Iceland is on a fault line. Here, the Earth's crust is warm as a result of being relatively close to the surface. This explains all the geysers and the massive use of geothermal energy in Iceland. Geothermal energy production doesn't have an intermittent character. Still, the geothermal plant will have some downtime due to maintenance and repair. Let's do another back-of-the-envelope calculation to estimate the potential of geothermal energy. The average heat flux in Earth's crust is about 50 milliwatts per square meter. A geothermal plant has an overall system efficiency of about 10%. It means that only 5 milliwatts per square meter of heat can be used. This leads to an achievable energy density of 43.8 watt-hours per square meter. Now let's look at an Icelandic power station to get an idea of its power output and capacity factor. This station is known to have a nominal capacity of 303 megawatts and an energy yield of approximately 2.3 terawatt hours. A significant amount of this energy is used for aluminium melting. With these numbers, we can calculate the capacity factor. We can see that the factor of this plant is remotely high with a value of 0.87. Typically, geothermal technology has a capacity factor of around 0.80. A main advantage of geothermal energy is that the plant can act as a baseload for electricity grid to eliminate the use of gas and coal plants. Another advantage is the long average lifetime of a geothermal plant of at least 30 years. After that, the heat reservoir needs time to recover again or will produce a lot less power. Finally, since the actual heat collection will take place underground, most of the ground above remains accessible. The land use of geothermal is very small. However, not all locations are suitable for geothermal power plants, and drilling to find the right rock type can be very expensive. Globally, geothermal energy is one of the smallest contributors in sustainable energy, with an installed capacity of 12.8 gigawatt in 2015. Nowadays, the global production of geothermal energy is 89.6 terawatt hours of electricity. If we divide it by the global population of 7.5 billion people and days in a year, we will get 32.7 watt hours per person per day. So what about the average power density? Geothermal energy has the lowest power density of this week's technology, with a value of 0.005 to 0.015 watts per square meter. If we consider the world's electricity demand in 2040, the total area of about 42 giga square kilometers doesn't fit on this world map. Geothermal energy is another piece of the puzzle to move towards a more sustainable future. It can be a continuous source of renewable energy that can balance the many intermittent sources. Finding a suitable location for a geothermal plant can be a challenge, however. In the next video, we will look into another type of energy, tidal energy.